evening, everybody, and welcome to the Brookfield Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, July 26th. Ask someone to please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. I will entertain a motion to approve the expense warrant for 6:30. Two sets, ratify the withholding warrant for 6:30, approve the payroll warrant for 6:30, approve the expense warrant for 7:14, and the payroll warrant for 7:14.
I will make that motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Announcements, due to safety concerns on Dunbrook Bridge on Quabog Street, the bridge at Dunbrook and the Route 9 end of Quabog Street will be closed until further notice is mandated by Mass DOT. The transfer station and Twister's Gym will be able to be accessed, and we will have a discussion first thing on the agenda this evening. Volunteers are needed, again, please, to serve on several town committees, including the Advisory Committee, Local Public Access Committee, Conservation Committee. Letter of interest should be submitted to the Board of Selectmen, 6 Central Street, Brookfield, Mass., 01506, or simply email selectmen@brookfieldma.us. Any other announcements?
Yeah, I do have one, Steve. I received earlier today from Holyoke Community College an offer of courses through the Quabog Valley Business Development Corporation and Quabog Valley Community Development Corp. The importance of this is the town of Brookfield is a part of this, of the Quabog Valley district. And our residents have access to these courses, one through the, Holyoke Community College, and also the courses given by Quabog Valley. And so I just want, since I just received this thing earlier this afternoon and wish to post it, I just wanted to share several copies with the board and the residents if they'd like.
So if we could get it up on Facebook, I think our resident Facebook is in-house.
No, right, good.
At the selectman's office. Are there refunds or advantage?
Aren't they at a reduced, I remember they used to come in, they were at reduced price.
That's correct, and in fact, the QuickBooks course is for free.
Yeah.
And what that does is if you take that class and you need some funding that the banks might not want to fund, they will fund because you've taken their classes.
Yes.
So there's some funding available as well. So it's a good thing for the residents to be aware of.
And FYI, I think seniors are eligible for free state tuition classes and whatnot, so that's
again, it's all good stuff.
Can I just give one to Karen?
Oh yeah, certainly.
And then Lindsay can possibly grab it.
Where's Lindsay go? Oh, there she is.
Back from vacay. Welcome back, ma'am. Any other announcements? Hearing none, anybody wish to address the board this evening that's not on the agenda? Nobody? Mr. Taft, welcome. Good evening.
Just a quick question on the volunteers, request for volunteers.
Yep.
The Master Plan Implementation Committee is also looking for...
We actually have somebody on this evening that we're going to place on.
Great. Okay. How about CIPC? Are you still looking for people for that? Or
not one individual is interested, even on the committees where the the bylaws state that each committee has to have a representative. Nobody. I think the only two were myself and Ms. Wilson were still interested. Obviously, we can't. And that's why I tried to get the two melded together at the annual last time.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Hearing nobody, agenda item number one, bridge closing. First and foremost, really, really need to let it known publicly that I'm speaking for the board, no doubt in my mind, is extremely appreciative of Cindy Thompson for working diligently on this, and Herb as well, who came from his vacation. We were informed last Tuesday, a week ago today, through the State DOT Division 3, Mohammed from the Bridge Department called the Highway Department, called the Selectman's Office, informed us that we had to close the bridge. Mr. Chafee was going to close the bridge on that Tuesday morning. I personally called Mohammed myself, got it extended until Monday. So we got almost a week. Purpose, obviously, we didn't want residents to leave for the morning and then come back with a bridge closed, no access. Thought it was the best thing for all residents. We've, as a board, all four of us here, Highway Department, have been working on this literally every single day. Mr. Snyder had actually reached out through email to our representatives. Ms. Gobi was reactive to those emails. Mr. Berthium was not. I personally called Mr. Berthium, I think, 2 days later when I didn't see a response. Got a phone call the next day. He actually spoke with, was it Jim or John from MassDOT? He's Mohammed's boss.
I think it's John.
John.
All right. I physically asked Representative Berthium to see if we could have a longer stay of execution, for lack of a better phrase, for the closing of the bridge. Absolutely 100% denied it. When I spoke with Mohammed Tuesday morning, 0% likelihood of any flow on that bridge. Reducing lanes, directional one lane, there was no way. We did not have the proof of what was going on picture-wise under the bridge until it was about 2 days ago in our office. Anybody that's seen these pictures, it's miraculous that the bridge has not collapsed at all. Completely, one's on an angle, probably a good 20, 30 degrees. Pretty much see through every single column. We talked about this when we did the Quaybog River Bridge. The town wanted to, through a resident, just replace the top of the bridge as opposed to the substructure of the bridge, and that's where we got into all the minutiae of it. We made the argument as a board, I don't think you two were on the board then.
No, I don't think so.
For $3.5 million at the expense of the federal bridge program, it was wise to physically do the entire bridge. That's what we did. That physical bridge is concrete on top. It's actually supported by wood timbers. Those need to be replaced. We are in the process of going out to bid. I think we might be under procurement laws. Under that for the 30, 35 for bids on that. If that is the case, did we get a call from Lennard yet for what they're going to charge?
No, we have a meeting with Lennard on Wednesday.
I'm just going to give a synopsis and then we can have a discussion.
Well, I'm just wondering if Cindy might be able to come to the microphone for that.
If you'd like to come up. And I'm just going to give a synopsis and then we'll elaborate off of those. Through our experience of working with engineers in town, we are comfortable with Lennard, their experience, their knowledge, expertise. If it is under that procurement, obviously calling the other two contractors, doing our due diligence, gonna go with Lennard Engineering. We need to physically get an engineered plan for that replacement, and it's gonna be and we've spoken to Cindy, an in-house fix, so the highway department can fix that and get the bridge open as soon as possible. Time frame in my mind is probably 2 to 3 months on that, just for design and then actually implementation. On the back end of that, Cindy has been talking to the state in regards to a temporary bridge. The emails that we see going through with Mohammed, unfortunately, come with $100,000 expense with engineering and installation. So regardless, I truly, truly believe we're gonna have to have a special town meeting. We only need 14 days for posting for that.
Yeah, 14 days posting and 10 days for voter registration.
So I think we're good there until we get all our I's dotted and T's crossed, because we really can't even do anything until an engineer's report comes forward both ways, how much a temporary bridge would cost to install and how much the pillars would cost just for a spec. So those are the two routes that this board's going through currently now. I did find out, I'm gonna tell you, this. I sit here and I talk about, you know, everyone says, why do you do this? And it's because of the people that are in this town, not only the citizens, but the people that work for you every day, the people that we pay taxes to. And one of them sitting right at this seat, and it's rude to point, but I apologize, the seat's over here. For lack of better words, we have a hell of a staff in Brookfield. They do an absolute amazing job, not just whenever we have to, but every single day. So my heart goes out to all of them. I spoke with the high school superintendent, associate superintendent. I wanted to give them a heads up in regards to the bus routes changing and whatnot, and the town's already reached out to them.
Yeah.
We've reached out to a lot of people. It's a very well-run machine. We have the interests of every single citizen in this town. The only other issue is emergency. We have residents. I believe one's in the crowd tonight talking about emergency. Email chains going back and forth in regards to stationing somebody on the other side of the bridge. I think we can look to our fire chief for comments on that. But I will let the other two members speak, and then the floor will be turned over to Ms. Thompson. Anything to add?
And defer to Cindy.
All right, the floor is yours, ma'am.
I'm gonna start with alternatives for the Quaybog Street Dunbrook Bridge first. Our alternatives right now are emergency bridge repairs, a temporary bridge. I think you all need to be aware that in 2011, we met with the state, Mass DOT, on the Dunbrook Bridge. The highway department at that point committed money out of Chapter 90 for our portion of what they at that time said would be probably a $100,000 fix for the bridge. The state said they would come up with the other $50,000. If we didn't come up with our portion, it was going to be the town's responsibility. We did come up with our portion. In this instance, the town of Brookfield is not at fault. For some reason or other, it fell through the cracks. A company went out of business. They were talking about doing epoxy and grouting to those piers underneath the bridge. That didn't happen. In fact, we actually had articles for a special town meeting that we pulled. At the time that they wanted to do this, the other bridge on Quaybog Street, the one down on the East Brookfield end, was scheduled to be closed. So we told them you can't close both bridges at the same time. You totally create an island for the residents down there. So I think that may be what happened. I can't say for sure. The steps we've taken to date, Brookfield signboard's been programmed and installed. We requested 15 detour signs from Mass DOT. The signs were picked up today in Medford, and they'll be put up probably tomorrow. We requested and received two signboards from Mass DOT. We contacted Malcolm Spiker for trapping the beaver out of Dunbrook. We've responded to numerous phone calls and visits from residents who are concerned. We've contacted McCarthy Bus Company. We've emailed 45 plus emails, and that doesn't include all emails that have gone back and forth to Selectmen's office to keep them informed. We've talked to the Army Corps of Engineers. We've installed Jersey barriers on the bridge. That was done Monday morning, which was our drop-dead date that it had to be done. We've completed a request for determination of applicability for the Conservation Commission. We've started the notice of intent application for Conservation and DEP. Our concerns, and I'm sure these are the concerns of a lot of the residents here, residents' access to emergency services. It's a 7.3-mile detour through East Brookfield. It takes 10 to 15 minutes longer. It's a 7.4-mile detour going via Rice Corner Road. Flooding, when, not if, the Quaybog River floods, approximately 300 adult residents plus children will be stranded in their homes. There's approximately 260 housing units down there that are affected. Flooding of Quaybog Street and Shore Road will prevent access to the pumping station of the public water supply. Access through East Brookfield has been inaccessible nearly every year for the past 15 years due to excessive high water, to the point that normal residential vehicle traffic has not been able to navigate the necessary route due to high waters. When the flooding happens, this road will no longer be able to be closed for safety reasons. For instance, a car traveling through high water may stall out, and then EMS services have no way to get through. Property damage due to the excessive wave action created by the high water. Historically, the highway department has placed Jersey barriers in front of homes to stop this wave action. We can't do that because we can't go over that bridge either. And remember, we can't control the time of year this may happen. Could be snow and ice damage, could be fuel oil deliveries that are having problems, power outages. So we understand that everybody is really, really concerned, and we're working really hard to try and get at least a temporary bridge in there for people. We spoke with the folks at the East Brookfield Highway Department. They installed a bridge very similar to the one that I received the directions for today. They've offered to help. So we're hoping, I mean, I have my fingers crossed, that if we can get an engineer to design the footings, which is what we need, and develop a plan, the highway department is going to try and put this temporary bridge together themselves. And I would like to think that we might, depending on the engineers, be able to get it done before school starts, because we really don't want to reroute those school buses. And that's pretty much where we stand.
So this will allow, is it going to be like a single lane traffic or double?
Single lane.
And so we'll need the stoplights and everything down there. More than likely.
possibly stop light or stop sign, stop, proceed with caution.
Because, you know, that route is used, it never was, it's just happened the last few years, it's become quite a commuter route.
Yes.
And I don't know if there would be some way that we could put that it would be for residents only, because what's going to happen
you can't.
You can't, but what's going to happen, we're not going to be able to get out of our driveways because the traffic is going to be down there so heavy.
So Cindy, when I heard that we can reopen the bridge if it floods, did we get that from the state? Did they confirm that?
No.
Okay, it'd be the action of the town of Brookfield, which I'm not opposed to.
No.
When I spoke with Mohammed, he said his wording was recommend. That's their verbiage, yeah. Is they recommend the town of Brookfield close it. It's a town of Brookfield bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Words mean something, so I alerted him to that, and he laughed, and he said if the town of Brookfield does not close that bridge, then the state will close
yeah.
it.
Yeah, he told me the same thing. I was here when the call came in too. And then I had talked to him about, you know, grants and things, and then you had sent us the article here that was in the Beacon, and he said the same thing, it would be 5 years or so for a grant.
Well, the other piece of this is I was already talking to CMRPC about assisting with a MassWorks grant application for Quabog Street.
Okay.
My suggestion is that we change our focus from drainage on Quabog Street to the Dunbrook Bridge.
Yes, I think we should.
Can we
too.
Incorporate the two?
It's $500,000
That's maximum.
Limit.
I think it should be focused for the bridge.
If we can do both, sure. But I think the bridge is more important.
It all hinges on that engineer, and that's why we wanted to work on that as soon as possible.
Yep.
Yes. Tomorrow afternoon.
That's when they said they're going to get back to you?
They'll be out. Ken Hodgson from Lennard will be out tomorrow afternoon. I have another engineering firm coming on Thursday.
So they're coming down to look at the bridge?
Yeah.
When would that...
1:30 for Lennard.
Okay.
And I haven't heard a confirmation yet for what time.
Okay.
And then when are they going to get the estimates in for design?
I'm going to shoot for the end of the week. I probably won't be that lucky, but I'm...
Well, we've done our due diligence, and we can assign a contract right down.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So we might want to have a meeting Tuesday morning or maybe even Monday morning. So just keep us abreast tomorrow of their time frame.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, I would call an emergency meeting. I think it would fall under emergency meeting.
Sure.
I would think so.
So now, who did you say was coming at 1:30?
Lennard Engineering
and
is
then,
coming at 1:30.
And
you have Dedham on Thursday.
It's yeah, and I can't remember the name of that engineering firm.
The idea of the Tuesday.
Yeah.
Week from now.
Mm. Oh, they wouldn't be out for another week.
Well,
no,
they'll be out Thursday.
But we wouldn't
There's
know price until possibly
Thursday.
Friday or possibly
Friday.
Monday.
Okay.
I'm hoping for Friday.
It's all procurement law. It's that's why government moves slow, because of all the regulations.
Procurement.
Unfortunately, they've said they feel it'll be expensive, and that
we
makes
know.
Me nervous. Yeah. But
I know.
So does any resident out in the crowd have questions for any of us or Cindy?
I've tried FEMA, I've tried MEMA, I tried Army Corps of Engineers. I didn't talk to National Guard.
The engineer units do have daily bridges that will not cause the community access.
Well, you should say that you have access to a bridge.
We have. MassDOT has found a bridge for us.
Okay.
They've accumulated enough pieces, now we just have to put them together.
We're liable for the engineering costs and the installation, which has been estimated to $100,000.
Yes.
Any other questions? I see you here.
One thing I wanted to say is I have an idea about McCarthy. Should I contact them directly?
I don't see why not. Mm. Either that or Deb Boyd.
Or what?
Deb Boyd at the school. The
Deborah
Boyd, the associate superintendent at the high school.
Okay. And the other thing I wanted to just say now, I mean, if you need to put in footings for a temporary bridge or something like that, you need to
go on
property.
Yeah. Oh, it's the same, yeah.
Okay.
Because you, like, I remember, because I lived down there all my life, I remember when they put that bridge back in 1961, they had put a temporary, they went through, my dad's property, it's mine now, but they went through and they had taken and they put a temporary bridge off to the right so people could go over. It was a whole separate bridge.
That's
went over
why it's called Prezio's Corner.
Yeah.
Hopefully the engineer will look at all the options.
Because that's what they had done years ago when they did it.
Any other?
Also, I've had a few people mention to me, is it possible to park a car on the Route 9 side of the bridge and leave it there?
I've had people call me too on that.
And so that they can get down there and get the car and go to work or whatever the case may be.
First and foremost, I'd leave that to the police chief.
Yeah.
And for public safety, knee-jerk, I would say no.
Mm.
Because then
we
can have 10. We have mutual aid.
Yeah.
East Brookfield is aware from day one.
Yeah.
I saw 2 days ago West Brookfield at Cumberland Farms. So, different towns.
I mean, they can't go over the bridge.
They can't go over the bridge, but parking there, in my mind, would create a cluster. And then you have a problem of getting out. It's just me personally, I think it might be a public safety issue. But I would contact the chief of police.
I see Peter and Donna in the audience, and I'm wondering if they might share with the...
Well, I'd like to hear from the crowd first.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
So if they have any other questions? I'm going to work my way back. Dave?
Yeah, I can't hear really here with the fans, but is there any way we can... Have we worked with the state to do one just pass only?
Yep, it's 0% passability.
Pass only, they won't even go
no.
for
that. Zero,
no.
0%.
You tried.
We've been trying, I tried for 4 days.
Where about, how are you doing with the financing on this bridge?
It's going to have to be a special town, but we can't post one until we know the amount.
Well, Cindy, you have an idea of how to pay a certain portion of it.
If,
so I think there's pieces.
Right. If we just learned this afternoon that this temporary bridge is available, money can be spent out of highway road reconstruction to hire the truck to haul a bridge to Brookfield. So we're not held up there.
I wouldn't haul anything to the town of Brookfield yet, money-wise, until we know the town wants to spend $100,000 on a temporary bridge. It'd have to be a special town meeting where the residents... I don't think... We don't have the money. The three of us can't arbitrarily say do it. It'd have to be before... We'd have a bridge that we paid for that the town could potentially say no to.
True.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, so we need our ducks in a row.
It hinges on Tuesday. Get some facts.
It hinges on the town allowing the spending.
Spending.
That's what I'm saying, because it would have to come out of stabilization.
Oh, the bigger expense.
$100,000 for a temporary bridge
is
a huge expense.
I would say,
and you need two-thirds vote for that, too.
So let's get our ducks in a row, which you've been doing, and we'll meet Tuesday if
I'm
we have to.
I'm hoping that $100,000 estimate is with somebody else putting the bridge in.
It's, to be honest, it's doubled in the past week. Originally it was 50, now it's 100.
Yeah,
it
keeps going up.
So hopefully it will
Every
go
time
down.
We ask, it goes higher, so I
So stop asking, yeah. let's get some other questions.
So what is the time horizon for the temporary bridge? Like, when could one be in place?
Realistically, a month.
It depends on the engineer. Realistically, if the engineer can get the plans for us, draw the footing plans, we're hoping we'd have it done by the end of August.
Okay.
School starts on August 30th, and that's our kind of goal right now. But.
Yeah.
But,
really?
But before flood season starts, it doesn't...
That's the intent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And to be honest with you, my rationale is if we have an engineer working, I'd rather have him working on a fix of the posts.
Yeah.
So we can get under there while it's dry, fix the posts, and get the bridge open, and then...
But that requires an Army Corps permit.
As far as I'm concerned, we do it, and we ask for forgiveness later. We I don't think we can... We have to do our due diligence. We did it with Lewis Field. I'll take the heat for that personally. You throw them my way. I have no problem with it. You have the applications in that this town needs access.
Oh, yeah.
We have emergency issues with flooding. I have no problem with that. I'll put that on my shoulder all day. But that's my path. My goal is to get an engineer in there, tell us in-house how to fix it.
Yeah.
We might not have to go to special town meeting to fix it, get the bridge open, and then replace, repair.
Definitely.
Get on the 5-year federal bridge again if we have to.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. Did you say that there's detour signs coming in?
They are here.
Yeah.
They picked them up today in Medford.
So they're going tomorrow?
Tomorrow, yep.
Because there's a lot of people coming out and they have no idea where to go. I
know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was Deb something, right?
Deb Boyd, B-O-Y-D.
Yeah, the state was kind enough to make 15 detour signs for
that's
us.
Good.
So.
People don't, we've had so many people come in and they wonder where they're going.
They were willing to work with us from day one. So
well, that's
Muhammad,
good.
A lot
that's
of
glad.
Thanks goes out to Muhammad as well. Dave?
Yeah. Cindy, you're talking about Chapter 90 money, right? For the temporary bridge?
No. Road reconstruction.
Okay, so we have that, and we also have Chapter 90
money. No, we don't have Chapter 90 money. They have not released that.
Okay, but I'm saying when they, if they do and when, that money, that those funds are possibly to be used.
Yes, they could be, but that was supposed to release that money April 1st, right, and we still haven't seen it.
Do we have a figure of what we have in there now?
Not off the top of my head, Dave.
Well, when they do release these, they were supposed to be released before now, right?
Oh, yeah. April 1st. Mm-hmm. April 1st is this.
So, let's say they do get released, then we will have access to that money. Correct?
There's $167,000 in this year's allotment. Okay. Yes.
Plus whatever we have left, minus Weber Road, like you said, and
minus Weber Road, minus River Street. Street, minus Mill Street, because FEMA hasn't okayed all our paperwork yet, and we don't want to cut ourselves short just in case.
Okay. Would we have to go to the town to use that Chapter 90 to use it towards a temporary bridge?
If it's not there, we can't use it. If it is there, we'd have to see what is there to use. And as far as I'm concerned, the board could okay. I don't see it as a potential. That to me, my path is a special town meeting out of stabilization. I'm looking at $100,000, possibly $200,000 at the end of this day. Ideally, I'd like to get Herb and Donnie under there and Mike and fix those columns within 3 or 4 weeks and get that bridge open again, without having to spend $100,000 on a temporary bridge.
Yeah. But the possibility is we can use Chapter 90.
If it's there, but
it's there.
We're hearing it's not.
It's not there.
So.
It's not right now, but it's earmarked for the town.
Well, 100%.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Will the pilings that are coming, they're replacing them, be up to quote?
That's where the engineer, the state, Cindy's actually reached out and said, what can we do? And Mohammed says we need an engineer. And that's that. Tuesday morning and Monday, and Wednesday, I've been through Karen, through Cindy, because I didn't want to have too many chefs in the kitchen. That's my priority, is an engineer, get a plan, and then we can move forward. That'll give us pricing, that'll give us time frame. That's everything. So the engineer is going to dictate what we can do under
there. Right, exactly.
Because the top of the bridge is in good shape. There's nothing wrong with the top of the bridge at all. It's in good shape. It's underneath.
Did I see your hand, Sharon?
No.
Any other questions? Gary?
If the bridge is closed and we put up a temporary bridge, why can't we not say it's for residents only?
I didn't hear the last part of that.
Why can't we not say it's for residents only? Is that a fact?
I'm 99% sure. I believe Cindy could probably confirm that
I'm
other 1%.
Sure we can't.
It's state roads. We get Chapter 90 money.
Because
the town of Brookfield does.
If it's a single lane traffic, at any given time,
it's
would be 50 cars lined up.
Yeah. But it's not a private road. Yeah. We get state money. We get federal money. It wouldn't happen.
The heck with the state.
No.
The state is set.
But the state's where the bridge is coming from.
The bridge is closed, but we don't care, you know, what happens.
So then the state says we want our bridge back.
Yeah.
So,
you got to play nice.
I mean, we need to do what's right for the residents, not what's right for the community.
To me, what's right for the residents, I see it as being the same time frame, fixing those pillars. I see it as the same. I'd rather put $100,000 into those pillars that are going to stay there forever than $100,000 into a temporary bridge that's going away. And to me, it's the same time frame.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we know the traffic.
Oh, I know as well.
And we know what. Yeah.
I used to work in that warehouse for a year. Yep.
It's going to be a nightmare.
Yep.
I would just like to say, and I don't know how everybody else in the room feels, but if we're talking $100,000 for a temporary bridge and $100,000 for a fix, but the fix is going to take a month or two longer, I just assumed we do the permanent fix and the road stays closed.
That's where I'm at as well, and I'm really happy to hear that from a resident that lives right on that corner.
Yeah, I
because I live on the
happen.
Other side of the town.
I'd rather see that happen too.
I mean, I would like to see, and I'm anxious to hear from Peter and or Donna what they can do for emergency issues. But if that can be covered in a somewhat comprehensive way, then.
Yeah.
That's the best word.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Dave?
what is going to be the purpose of the special town meeting?
Money, funding.
Where is it going to come from?
It's going to have to be stabilization as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, that's what's going to
be. First, you're going to check with the engineers and then we can get a price.
Or we could always raise and appropriate. We're still under under the levy.
We're going to talk to the engineers this week.
I'm still saying we've got to look into Chapter 90 and see where we can go ahead.
We're going to look at everything, Dave.
The authorization to do Chapter 90.
We're going
to
look at everything, trust me.
Yeah. You guys are on the right page
then. Yep.
Anyone have another question? I would now invite the chiefs, fire chief and EMT, to if they'd like to come up and address in regards to public safety. Welcome, folks. We'll start with you first.
Okay. As soon as we found out, we contacted East Brookfield Fire Department. They said they would be more than willing to help us out. If it's something acute, severe emergency, they're going to come in, grab, and go out. If it's something that can wait a few more minutes, they said they will go to the house, stabilize, make sure the patient's okay, and wait for us to come pick up the patient.
So time frame versus you coming out this door versus East Brookfield going out their door, is it pretty equivalent?
East Brookfield is in their station during the day, so they're full time, so they can leave immediately and go to it.
So it's actually quicker.
So it's quicker for East. And at night?
The same thing.
At night, in each case, it's depending on where the on-call staff for each town is. It may very well be at some points where they're quicker.
And that's the same as fire. That's the same as fire, I'm assuming.
Fire discussion with Chief Livermore and his staff was the same thing. If dispatch deems, or based on people we have in that area, if it's a CO alarm chirping or a cellar pump, will handle it. Anything else, flame showing, smoke showing, multiple calls of an incident, East Brookfield will respond as if it was their own, in force according to their response order. We would go also, and then once we get there, we'll work it out. The one positive grace on fire protection is it's within the hydrant district, so the need for tankers isn't there. The only other issue is it limits our normal ability to respond to Quaybog Pond. So the two towns we depend on for dive response, Spencerville, Brookfield, were notified. They need to come in from the East Brookfield side with dive response. Because of the current water level, boat access on Quaybog Pond is very limited, so we're looking that if we need to deploy a boat to Quaybog Pond, we're probably going to do it from the river. The river's still high enough that boat deployment is easy, and then we'll just run up the river for that. But any dive of people in the water type thing will be done from the boat ramp, but from shore road.
I was even going to offer you, if you wanted to keep a fire truck down the end, you could put one on our property. We don't have any problem with that at all.
Yeah.
If you wanted to do it, it's your option.
We actually heard an erect our brains trying to think of if there was some enclosed building down there that could suit. The only thing on it is that there are only two fire personnel that live in that area that they're affected. They're both keeping their gear with them. They're both equipped with portable radios. They're both well-seasoned people.
Mm-hmm.
And they know if something comes in that area, they're going right there and they're giving us eyes on as soon as practical, so we can adjust more so or lessen the effect of a response based on theirs. Same thing. In conversation with Chief Blanchard, I know he was in conversation with East Brookfield State Police, and including the environmental police, so if something comes in, whoever is available will get there just for eyes on, so we have that immediate. The reporting party is always good, but depending on the circumstances, they may not be in a position to give us the best, so that's where we're really counting on our personnel, either in place or there. So.
And it's not even the word comfortable with the mutual aid. I think it's impressed. I think the word has to be stressed that we're impressed with the availability of mutual aid and the level of expertise on that side.
And East Brookfield is really the only community that's in position to impact us. Sturbridge would be too far out. Okay. And East Brookfield's resources would be adequate. Because again, we'd be back in the month as soon as possible.
And they're right there on that back road too.
Yeah.
That.
When if you actually map it out, if you're familiar where Red Gable Road is, just on the other side of the Quaybog Bridge, from the East Brookfield Fire Station to Red Gable is actually shorter than from our fire station to Red Gable. So there's certain aspects of it. The dimensions we were operating from our fire station to the town line, 6 miles, 10 minutes, normal flow of traffic. we tend not to do normal flow of traffic. It's been discussed, I think Cindy had mentioned it too, as if we went around the other way, West Corner Road, South Pond Road up there, things, Route 9, we can get up and go a little bit quicker. We don't have any hills to navigate. I'm more comfortable going to Route 9 Road than up and around. We've got a polarized corner road. We've got to pull the hill on East Brookfield on the other side, and it's more of a roller coaster. We got on Route 9, we're out. And then, you know, we really have to slow down when we get out to Podunk Road. But by the time we're on Podunk Road, it's very far until the East Brookfield will be on the scene. So.
We have two EMTs that are on the other side of that detour, too.
Okay.
So they're going to have, you know, their basic first responder gear and a bottle of oxygen to help do what they can until someone gets there.
Yeah. I've noticed the East Brookfield police have been coming down.
Yeah.
They come down quite a bit.
That's it. They've always, East Brookfield, you noticed over the years, they'll even, they do that section of Shore Road.
Yeah.
They go to the boat ramp, just look through. Yeah. Very often they just continue up Playbook Street, come out on Route 9. I fully expect Chief Bernard on that end. I can't speak with Chief Blanchard, Chief Bernard. They'll just pass through. And they're all on the same radio channel.
All the towns do it.
They're aware of it, but they're all on the same radio channel, too. So it's not even that the dispatcher has to put any more effort into it. They're making one call for any unit available. This is what's going on the affected streets. So,
does anybody have any questions for our chiefs? Thank you.
Thank you.
And again, thank you to everybody that's putting time and effort into this. Residents, 200-300 houses down there haven't been forgotten. Working every day, and we'll continue to work on it until it's resolved. And thank you, Cindy, the Highway Department as well. Thank her and all the guys down there.
I think Cindy should be commended for all the work that she has done down there. She's done above and beyond.
Thank you, ma'am.
Just one other thing as we get off of this, that I attended a session down in Worcester CMRPC a week ago where they're talking the monies to study the roads in this area and the like. And $53,000 was allocated. And one of the roads that I pointed out to that group was, in fact, this route, because it's become such the commuter route. And it really, what it impacts is, we talked about the rural 11 communities.
Yeah.
It really is kind of like the needle in the middle. So there is money.
Did you stress that at that meeting?
Yes.
Thank you.
Without knowing about bridges at that point.
Now, one other question I had with Cindy. Now, we wouldn't know the bus would come over the temporary bridge. Could it hold the temporary bus?
The bus would come over.
But how about would trucks be banned from it? I hope.
I don't know.
They're going to have their weight limits, and that's where engineers come in.
Because that's what really did it on the other bridges. It was the trucks.
And the height on weight limits can enforce because
that's right.
Those weight limit signs were up. On the both sides of the bridge, I'm going to guess
one of them's kind of hidden. It's extremely hidden. You don't see it until you go looking for it, like I did last week.
And we had
two on each side. Yeah.
But
so
the one going towards Route 9 is kind of tucked in there.
Yeah, they are.
Well, there's one right before the bridge, which would be higher, but then there's one before that. And I mean, I don't know if we can get the state.
That's who would enforce it as a state.
Yeah, but if we can ask them to come down, point someone to get something.
I believe it would be the state.
We've had, since they had put the other bridge down there on Quaybog, we've had much more trucks, the heavy trucks. We have the trucks that are coming from 49, the car trucks.
Yeah, they dumped it from down yesterday.
I know yesterday, and some of these vehicles that come around the corner, they can barely make it. And I mean, I don't think they should be coming down our way.
A lot of it, the onus is on that CDL driver, too. That's why we have the signs. They can be fined and they know.
Yeah.
Any other questions before we move on? Thank you again, everybody, for your patience. Cindy, can you stay for this discussion for number two as well? Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Stendrup, if you could come on and join us. Item number two, trees. From our last meeting, we had the discussion of where we want to move in regards to moving forward on tree removal. Mr. Stendrup and I had a conversation the next morning. Cindy, I think the key issue here is where our current individual is. Herb told me himself that he has another job and he can only work on weekends. So that kind of takes him out of the picture, doesn't it?
So what happens if we have issues such as East Main or...
We'd have to call to see what the work schedule is.
All right, so that's why Mr. Stendrup and I had a conversation in regards to actually going out to bid for one contractor that'll take care of this and get everything done moving forward.
I'm not opposed to going out for bid. I just want to make sure everybody's very clear as to our current practices and what we did this year. I've done a study for my advisory board friends so that they understand what it costs us this year. So that I just want to be clear.
Well, that's what the budget was founded on, was that setup.
Oh, I know. And I just want to, again, you'd be going out for bid, and I have no problem with that. But I did lay out, with Cindy's help, a flow chart of what we do today, some concerns that Bill offered, and what we might be able to do to mediate the concerns that he has beyond the quoting to get somebody else available to us. So I just I want to share what I've learned. But as
so,
far as
yeah,
going
if you
out
can do that, then the floor will be Mr. Stendrup's.
If it's as simple as his interest to go out for bid, I think that that's a good idea. I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
Is that what you're proposing?
That's my interest this evening, is to go out to bid.
To go out to bid. So I personally don't have an issue with going out and getting a bid. However, in the midst of this, we have received, and I think, Karen, you put it back in the envelope.
The bid.
There was an additional bid that came in. I don't know how. A quote came in. And what I did, based on that quote coming in, I've taken a look at what that costs the town, and I just want to make sure we're clear as to what the roads forward might be.
Is that the bid that came in 2 weeks ago for East Main?
The one that came in 2 weeks ago. I think
you might
still have it, because...
Well, that's the one.
No, no,
no. Isn't that the one Mr. Stendrup solicited?
Oh, then it should be... Oh, I know where it is. It's right there.
Right there.
Yeah, it's the one that Mr. Stendrup solicited.
Yes. Yeah. So, Cindy, do you want to step up here again, and you guys can share that one? So just to ground us all as to what happened in the last fiscal year, as far as what we've done, is that a process or practice was put in place where the tree warden identifies, and with that, Cindy had maintained a list. Cindy added to that list as time went on. The highway department scheduled the work. The contractor came in and did the high work, the highway department chipped, and the good news is we learned in this practice that Cindy in fact created a best practice, and what she's done to notify the residents as far as removals. And what we then would have is the butts of those logs would then be removed by highway. In fiscal 16, we went ahead and paid that contractor $17,000 for an average on those 58 trees of $296. It's essentially 20 days worth of work. His charge to the town is $840 a day. The other impact is the highway department working on the ground basically averaged about 3 men for those same 20 days. It cost the town $9,600. That's kind of what I call sunk money, that you budgeted those workers, and so therefore it really doesn't really get to get counted.
I look at it as opportunity cost, to be honest with you.
Yep.
We're paying it out to the highway and we'll just delegate where they're going to be working.
Good point. And so in my conversation with Bill as well, there were three issues that stuck out, Bill, from our conversation. The first time was the issue of additions to the list. Mm-hmm. The second was town liability working with a contractor.
Right.
And then the third was safety protocols related to the power lines.
Correct.
Right? So those were your issues.
Yeah, right? Not necessarily in that order.
But those were your issues, well-founded.
Yeah.
The other piece that I learned in this process was the responsibilities of the tree warden. And again, you are responsible for the cover on the town property.
Right.
And so totally get that. So what I did is on the second page, if you'll turn there, the suggestion that I'm making, Bill, as to fiscal 16 to fiscal 17 is that really we need to put a do loop in, a feedback loop with respect to additions. Because you were concerned about a particular addition to the list.
Among others.
Okay, among others. So in 58 trees, how many others? just to give a sense of it?
I don't know, because many were added and then removed subsequently before my being being able to assess those.
Okay, so but again, the point was we moved 58 trees. We have currently on the list 54 trees, and I'm under the impression that you have approved the removal of those 54 trees.
That's in question.
So good. So we have a process here that says that Cindy can give you the list back and say, here's the 54 for fiscal 17, so that we can be assured that the 54 trees that we have left, and maybe some additions, but roughly 54 trees. So about the same population as we had in FY16, we have for FY17. So what we allocated in FY17 was about $17,000, is if I got my numbers right, Dave. Maybe you can.
17 is what we have in there now.
Exactly. 17. So we have 17.
17.5.
Okay. All right. So 17.5. So again, looking at FY16 to FY17, if we have 50 odd trees to go that we've allocated based on our past practice, we've allocated sufficient funds and coverage to get it done. And that's the only point. So what I would suggest is we move forward with getting bids and understanding how we might change the process, that I'd look to Cindy to recirculate the list back to Bill to make sure we're clear that these are approved trees, and that should any addition come to you, again, you tend to be the focal point of hearing about this, that there would be a feedback loop between the two.
Usually what happens when I get a resident's concern is I email Bill, and then he responds from there. That's pretty much how we've been taken care of it the last, I would say, year.
Yep. So it's seeming to work. That would be what I would say.
I guess the only piece that might be missing there is you letting me know that it's okay to remove those trees.
Right. I hear what you're saying.
Again, that would force them.
I know I send them to you, but I don't think I ever hear back. This one isn't an issue, or
there is a breakdown in communication, and I appreciate you going through the exercise here and putting that in there. That does close the loop, and so I'm all about solutions here and how we're going to improve our communication so that no one is feeling left out of the loop here. And most importantly, the things are being done in the town that the taxpayers are paying for, which my chief responsibility is for the safety of the residents with regard to the trees. And monitoring that and being able to delegate that work. My frustration was with feeling that my input was at times passed over, and that decisions were made that I objected to, and those decisions were outside of what I felt were appropriate actions that were taken. And I mean, case in point, there were some removals performed at the cost of the town, which I specifically had asked that they not be performed, and those requests were ignored. So the town, in effect, paid for certain removals of what, you know, I later determined to be healthy trees, and you know, that was the beginning, not the beginning, but that was a part of the frustration. Yeah,
so again, exactly. By putting a loop in,
right,
we got a tree, we've got to do something about it,
right,
have you in the loop to make sure that it's appropriate, and then we can move forward.
And processes are great.
That's why you have this in front of you.
Right.
All right. So the second, and again, we just close out on that page where the highway chips and removes as we do. The next page is the liability concern. And this was something where we've been past practice. We've taken advantage of the contractor. He works high, the town works low, and we own a chipper, so there's an economy in having the chipper, economy in having workers available to do the work. So the concern that I had, Bill, and this was taking the quote that came in for the four trees, and again, four trees at 4 hours is not the quote that you're looking for, but just taking that as an example where that person will do both high and low work. and that's right. What I'm suggesting here.
Okay.
What that quote was for $175 an hour, which translates to about $1,400 a day, where he's got the both crews high and low. What if we say that the 20 days that we worked on last year was about the 20 days we're going to work on this year, that's some $28,000 cost to the contractor. So again, I'm a bit concerned when we get the quotes in that when we have the contractor doing both high and low work, that has a cost to the town of could be as much as $10,000.
Sure.
So I wanted to make sure that you were aware that when we come back to the quotes and whatnot, that you understand that we really want to push on, and Cindy's done some research on liability, that we really think that where we're working and how we're working today, we don't really face that liability. Cindy, do you want to address that?
No, that's I spoke with our insurance carrier. I checked with some of the tree wardens around. Basically, the town is liable if somebody gets hurt in the town roadway, no matter what we do. I mean, that's just how it is. There does not appear to be increased liability if our department is working with the contractor. That was the best research.
I think most contractors, if we go out to bid, are just going to say they don't. I would, if I was coming out, I wouldn't want to work with the highway department because it's going to increase my liability. That's just how I would.
We have a certificate of insurance from.
But I'm just saying personally, I've never worked with those individuals. I don't know what they're capable of. I don't want to hurt my guys. Yeah. I don't want to hurt my equipment. Yeah. I don't want to hurt people that are traveling on the road because of my.
I think because we have past experience working with the contractor we currently have.
He's comfortable with it. Yeah.
They're comfortable with it.
But going out to bid, there's not going to be that comfort level.
Correct. Right.
And so in the analysis of the bids, we've got to understand that and see our way through that.
We had that discussion. I think we both agreed that people that are going to bid on this are going to want to do it themselves. That they're not going to want to work in tandem. Yeah.
And my only concern is that we've had a practice that is cost effective. I'll put it that way.
I completely understand. But we're going in two different directions here. It's not just in your tenure in the past 2 years.
Yep.
Right when this all started and changed about 4 years ago, it's flashing ahead.
Are we taking into consideration cost of police detail?
I didn't.
That's subjective, I think.
That would
case
be
by case.
Something else that we need to think about. Currently, I flag for the highway department.
They might have someone on their staff that flags themselves.
Typically, a four-person crew in a tree company will have a flag person if they'll be at a lower rate.
So my question is reading this, what we call an RFQ?
Yeah, RFP, RFQ, whatever.
Reading this, it states two individuals, both arborists. This kind of precludes Mr. Sierra from bidding on this.
That in the utility line clearance certification as well.
Yeah, we've got that on the next page.
Yeah. This is just common practice in the industry, you know, what's required among municipalities when they contract.
Do we want to put language that if they're willing to work with the town, there's a certain price?
We can make it say whatever we want. That's of a benefit to the town.
Do you recommend that, or you recommend going with strictly?
I would recommend that we not include that language at this time, but offer it as either an addition to or an incentive. To a contractor.
An option. It could be an option on your RFQ.
But it would have to be in writing.
Okay. It would need to be in writing. Right. And then that the contractor would understand the liability involved there. You know, and I understand that the town does have its own insurance, and the contractor coming in would also be required to have that insurance. My issue lies in an event where either the contractor or the town is responsible for a loss to the other, then how would that play out? And I don't know, I'm not an insurance agent, and I don't know what that would look like in the event that a loss was caused by one to the other.
This comes back to, and I took it really personally, and I bit my tongue, everything that was in my mouth, when we were accused, not only the board, but the advisory committee, of being drunken sailors spending the town's money frivolously. Hmm. It's highly insulting. We work every day to save this town money, and we don't do it in a penny-wise, pound-foolish way. We dot our I's and we cross our T's. The issue with this is that 10,000 piece, maybe even more.
Yeah, and so again, I would look to an option on this quote to determine whether or not there are alternatives before we make a decision. I mean,
is that something they'd be willing to incorporate into a proposal?
Sure, we can put anything in there that we feel is of a benefit
to the
town.
Some things might have to be rewarded, though.
Oh, absolutely. This is just an example of what we might put forth to prospective bidders for an annual contract. And I guess the point being that this would allow us the flexibility to have on retainer a contractor that we could identify either half of a day's work or a full day's work, an emergency services contractor. I know that Ed's definitely helped the town out on a number of occasions.
But I'm going to reference about 2 years ago, we reached out to Ed and he was extremely busy and he couldn't do anything for the town. If we have them under contract, they'd have to come out and we wouldn't have issues that we had 2 years ago.
Well, and it may mean that you have one or two or three. This bid that came in is reasonable for what was.
I think that was the one that we talked about for East Main.
It was a reasonable bid. But the it was a reasonable bid. At the same time, what it did is it changed the practice of how we were doing the work.
That's what we're talking about here. And it got messed. I think the communication got a little bit distraught through the highway department. I say distraught because there was emotions there.
Oh, yeah. And that's why you reduce it to a process. And what's the best thing to do?
So can you revise something for the board that we can look at our next meeting? And as Cindy says, the issue is we rarely cut trees in the summer because of the foliage. But once the leaves start falling, we want to get back at it again.
Right. Well, there are a few other items that I think we need to consider as well. And one is Emerald Ash Borer. If it's not already here, in fact, I'm doing some monitoring for the state, for their biologists within the town on state land, and to detect the presence of it. We need to get a handle on what we have for ash trees within the town, because it's not a matter of if, it's when they start to fall apart on us. And the real unfortunate part to that is they don't just fall over. They tend to be pretty catastrophic when they do let go. My company has mandated that no ash trees are to be climbed, so they understand the seriousness of this. So that being said, we would have at our disposal, if we had a contractor, someone that could work with us in the identification of healthy versus unhealthy trees, ash in particular, to mitigate those threats before they become liabilities. So that's just one instance.
So you kind of, pardon me, Mr. Chairman, but we're going off to another. We have 54 trees in front of us. If we need to set aside, and I look to the chairman of the advisory board, if we have to go set aside another bunch of money, we probably ought to start thinking about it between now and special town meeting. I mean, I look to the chair, but again, if that's something that's near term, I think we need to get to it. As much as we need to get to an alternate contract.
Absolutely, and I've been exploring funding for such instances, and I attended a conference that USDA did let us know that those folks with management plans in place would be first considered for any federal funding that's made available for ash tree mitigation. So that's another component to think about. It doesn't have anything to do with.
Do we have a cutting plan
for ash trees?
For the trees that we have, do we have a cutting plan?
We have a number of trees which are identified as hazardous. Is there a plan in place to cut those trees? There is not, because we don't currently have a contractor on retainer that is performing that work.
Yeah, are there grants available for that work?
For cutting?
No, well, that would be nice too, but I might doubt that.
Yeah.
But the identification would be of interest to me.
Mm-hmm. There is grant money available through the state.
Should we be applying for that money?
Absolutely, and it's a challenge grant that's due in the not too distant future, which I'm.
You got the ball.
I've got the ball. Right. Yeah, through the DCR. So that's just one component of it. But I mean, my interest is in the tree canopy health in the town here, and. If
through this discussion, my interest is securing an individual a group company to be a contractor for the town of Brookfield, so we can move forward.
Agreed. Likewise. Yeah.
In an effective, business-like manner.
And I do appreciate Mr. Snyder's. Process flow charts here, and I think that, you know, Cindy and I can definitely work together. Sure. As far as maintaining
regardless of who cuts our trees, we still need cooperation.
Exactly.
Between the two departments.
I've been maintaining a list of residents who want wood. Yeah. So if I know there's wood located Allen Road, I start down the list with the people who live closest to Allen Road first. And go through the list and notify everybody. We've probably got approximately 20 people.
And it's gone before anyone from that list goes and gets it.
Sometimes, and sometimes they send me back an email that says, I can't find the wood.
Yeah, that's what I mean, it's gone. Yeah.
It's gone.
So there was one other, back to the last chart, is that there was issues around power lines and safety around power lines.
Right.
And in conversation with her, if they get into a situation where they're dealing with a power line, their preference is to deal with National Grid or whoever the owner of the lines are to do that work. So there is a preference on the part of Highway that they not do the work.
I understand preference, but I mean, if they're...
We've done this in the past. You've reached out to National Grid and we've had trees removed.
Yeah. What I also learned is, one, that's one way you can go do it, and it's a good way, right? At the same time, there was a safety training done 4 years ago, 3 years ago, Cindy?
I think it's four.
Four.
Now.
So we did, the town, in fact, did bring assets in to do safety training around power lines. And what I'm suggesting is, and I suggested to her, and I would say, Bill, the two of you getting together on safety training would be actually an asset to make sure that we redo what we did and probably sure. improve upon.
Well, to the highway department to keep them safe, because they will have to go out for emergencies.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah. So again, I think that we've learned some things in putting these charts together that will benefit everyone.
So you can put a new RFQ together based on this conversation?
I will do that.
Present it to the board and get it done? Beautiful. Okay. Questions, comments?
Yep.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Dave.
I don't know. What was the figure she quoted? It was going to be about...
If you
had a contractor, you'd be spending $14,000.
No. We have a bid for 4 trees at a half a day, and if you ran that out, it would be $1,400 a day. I took the 20 trees, 20 days of work that we accomplished 58 trees. We have 54 trees left, so I said 20 days, yeah, close enough. And so I multiplied 1,400 times the 20 days, that's $28,000. What happens is that would mean we'd cut a check for some $28,000 for that scope, and just again, this is rough estimates, but for that quote, we would cut a check to a sub-supplier of the town for $28,000 for that amount of work. Where my concern lie is in that we paid a contractor at $840 a day, but he did not do the chipping. And that amounted to $17,000 for FY16. And now, going forward, suggesting that others would do the chipping and some of the removal, we'd still be responsible for some removal of the butts and whatnot. That, given that, the highway department at the moment, for the 58 trees expended three guys through those 20 days. And so that cost to the town would be roughly $9,600. So on paper, it would be $27,000 versus $28,000. But the reality is the $9,600 is actually a sunk cost because the employees already work for the town. You already had to pay them. Now you're looking to not only pay them, but you're looking to pay a contractor. And so that was my concern. And as we go forward and analyzing things, we need to be safe and we need to do it efficiently. That's all.
Okay, so I can take numbers and...
Well, Dave, basically the 9.6 or 9.7 I don't have in front of me is opportunity cost. The money's already allocated for a line item for wages.
This discussion is about efficiency and production on trees.
But
I mean, I don't care if there's 54. We're always going to have trees that need to be cut. We keep talking more and more trees. It's going to be a continuous year-to-year thing.
Every day.
But the thing is, you got to have a guy. He's got a quote. I think he was $175 an hour for 3 days. Mm-hmm.
But that was for one particular instance. It's not for a whole contract for the whole year.
No. I'm just saying, you hire someone for $175 an hour, April.
He didn't hire him. He's got a quote for
right.
him.
Right.
Quote for him.
Okay, for argument's sake, yeah.
Okay, so he's going to have his own trucks, his own gas, the whole nine yards. He's going to drive it himself.
Right.
Okay. Now, if we have three men from our highway, it's going to be $195 an hour, roughly. But if we have the other guy, the other contractor, comes up to about $195 an hour. So it's $20 more an hour. But we also have to figure in the efficiency here. Because the guy that we're using now, we should keep him on board as well as having another contractor on board, like we're trying to do. But the guy we have now, I've seen him sit down at the highway plant, getting paid, and they don't leave until 7:45. And this is many, many, many days. Okay, I see it with my own eyes. It's not opinion now, Clarence.
You're welcome.
It's factual. And I've had other people say the same thing to me. So you gotta factor that into this figure. Okay? So what you're gonna do, we have $175 an hour for a guy with his own crew versus $195 without guys. That's not counting gas and this and that. But another thing is if the highway is so damn busy, in the summertime, when you meet somebody, and they should be doing what they have to be doing in the summer, which makes sense too. So when is our tree guy going to be able to come back with us? When is he going to be able to start working
once,
with the highway again?
Once paving's done.
Huh?
Frost.
So you're talking November, December 1st?
We've historically done most of the tree cutting in Brookfield through the winter, early spring.
Right, okay. But I'm saying if we have something that came up that needs to be addressed and we have nobody, I mean, we should have another contractor which is going to be for backup.
If I might?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. And I do hear Mr. Holcroft's point, and I understand it. Efficiency is the name of the game in the tree business. And what you get with a $1,400 a day contractor as opposed to an $800 a day contract is double the production. So if you've got a backlog of X number of trees, you make up for that difference in dollars, supposedly, by the efficiency of a professional crew. And I'm not knocking anyone here. I'm saying to each their own profession.
So where we are is, I think Mr. Holcroft and I have actually agreed on something this evening. Having an alternate set of bids would actually be a good thing as we take the next step in evaluating what we should be doing.
I think to look back to where we were, we need that RFQ in front of us and move forward from there.
I think that's true. And I just a few questions I think that I have for the board before I start writing the RFQ. Are we looking at lowest bid? Or are we looking at best value? And the distinction between the two is you would, in a best value contract, it would be a weighted score where the bid price would be considered along
is
with
it. Is there a rubric to it or is that your discretion?
No, there's a rubric. You have an actual, that you have criteria that are needing to be met.
You set the criteria.
Exactly.
I'm with best value.
Well, I did. You need to look at the matrix.
Yeah. Well, you'd be responsible for the rubric, and
right.
Nobody in this room can develop a better rubric than Mr. Stendro.
Exactly.
So are you guys on board with best value or best cost?
Well, again, I think you look at
the best value.
Value is the key.
So there's your answer.
Excellent. And then I can move forward under that, with that in mind, that it's a best value.
What does procurement say about that?
Well, where that you're allowed is that low bid is still considered. The only reason you throw out low bid is that there's another value that this guy wins on.
I think we've been down this road of not choosing lowest bidder before.
Of not choosing lowest bidder?
Correct.
Okay. But if there's two avenues to have a proposed
and
request.
It amounted to talking to the Attorney General.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We've got to be careful.
Yes, we have to be very careful.
So the wording of the request has to be very careful.
You have to have proof of why you're not choosing.
So that rubric is very important.
Oh, yes.
I personally would like to have it written where our current in-house supplier, lack of better words or phrasing without throwing names out there, would be able to bid on it.
Oh, absolutely.
Sure. Oh, sure. Yeah.
But it would preclude him just in the first paragraph where he's got two arborists on. Sorry.
And that all becomes a part of the criteria. You know, what is everybody bringing to the table here as far as value?
Yeah.
Do we need to then sub out somebody that's line certified? Do we need to sub out someone that has a crane? I mean, these things all become costs, situation to situation, and need to be considered. So, I will do my best to put together the.
So maybe before you submit it to the board, maybe work with Cindy to see what she can recommend as well.
Sure.
Keep us out of trouble.
If she doesn't mind. Dave?
Bill, you're throwing a figure of $1,400 out for a contractor, right?
For example.
Okay. But if the town's going to do it the way they're doing it, the same thing, it's going to come to $1,560. So it's still higher with the town. But it's better if the highway does it in the wintertime. I agree, because they have time to do it then.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it'd still be higher than the contractor.
I gotta look at your numbers.
Go do the math. You just said
that. I have the math on the floor.
We have 100 different scenarios that we could throw in front and snowball down.
No, I'm not throwing figures around. So 105 now for the guy.
Yeah, but yeah,
you figure out 95 for the workers. Add it up.
So let's see where the RFQ comes in, and we'll go from there.
Yep. That sounds good.
All right. Beautiful.
Okay.
Beautiful.
I got a question for Chris, though.
One last question.
No, it might be a couple.
No, it might be the last, so make it articulate.
Bill, ash trees.
Yeah.
I want to set this board straight, and I want to set the highway department straight in this town, okay? When you came up and we checked my town trees out on the site on East Main Street, we mapped town trees before I moved the house up there, correct?
Uh-huh.
We discussed those ash trees that were dead and dangerous, okay? And those trees have been dead when we came up there to move the house. Remember that conversation.
I'm thinking.
Okay. So what I'm trying to say is these trees, they said all of a sudden just died, and then one fell over, and they said the house ran into it, which is totally ludicrous. Okay, that came from the highway. They said the house hit the tree last meeting there, okay? Then they says that didn't fly. So then he says, oh, when you dig your driveway up, you disturbed the root system. I only went down 6-8 inches. So that didn't happen. And if you went up and looked at the tree, it broke off at the bottom. The tree does not die that quickly in a year's amount of time, a year or 5 months.
I did look at those trees, and I vaguely recall our conversation. When I did see those trees, my assessment was that the root systems had been compromised in those trees. What was the event that caused that?
Right.
That's undetermined. It could have been during the construction process. It could have been in the road repaving effort. And any number of reasons could have caused the decline of those trees. When ash trees decline, they decline fast. So I think that there were a number of factors which contributed to the decline of those trees. not the least of which was the compromised root systems.
Right. Well, I'm just saying, you were dead when we mapped those trees, the town trees, to be cut before we moved the house up there. I'm just saying. I'm just trying to set this town straight, because I'm sick of listening to the lies saying that the house...
All right, so...
No, I'm going to finish what I...
David, it has nothing to do with this discussion. If you want to talk to him about it later, you can do that.
The house did not hit the trees, and that's not why the trees came down. The trees were dead... All right,
so you said it three times, we're good.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Bill.
Item number three, I'll entertain a motion to appoint Ms. Pierce to the Master Plan Implementation Committee to expire June 30th,
2019. I'll make
that. Second, and it's
I will make
Pierce.
It.
Pierce, Pierce.
Morgan Pierce. I'm actually a cousin, do you know that?
Okay. I did not.
All right.
So, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Entertain a motion to appoint Ms. Esposito. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Esposito.
As Assistant Animal Control Officer.
Yes.
I'll make that motion.
Second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
She's busy already.
Item number four, setting meeting dates. Looking at this, instead of having a morning meeting next Tuesday, let's just start with our annual Tuesday meetings, if anybody's not opposed to next week on the 2nd.
Second.
Okay, let me get my calendar right here.
So I'm going to say the 2nd, the 16th.
You want to do one on the 2nd, okay.
Ooh, I'm going to be gone on the 16th.
I'm going to be gone on the 16th, too.
I'm going to be on vacation that week, too.
So if you want to say the 2nd, the 9th, I'm sure we'll have something to talk about. If not, we'll cancel it. So the 2nd, the 9th. Okay. The 9th would basically put us in the two-week cycle of today to pick back up.
And then the 30th?
The 23rd.
Oh, the 23rd. And then we'll move on into September.
2-9-23.
2-9-23, and then September 6th.
Labor Day is the 5th, right?
I don't know.
I think so.
All I know is I start building a house on the 12th. Do we not want to do the 6th?
September 6th?
No, I just wanted to comment that I thought the 5th was Labor Day.
Are we good with the 6th?
I'm good.
Labor Day is the 5th.
Yeah, I just
so
wanted to
make sure.
So we're
good with
the
6th then, no?
The 6th, yeah.
6 is fine.
6th and the 20th?
Yep.
And then October. October 4th.
What was the 2nd September date?
September 6th and September 20th.
Okay.
And then October 4th and October 18th.
Okay.
That's it for the three-month cycle.
Question?
Yep.
These times will remain at 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock, yeah.
And would you like to continue
newspaper coverage? Love to have newspaper coverage. For both reporters in the room. So I will entertain a motion for August 2nd, 9th, 23rd, September 6th, 20th, October 4th, and 18th.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Item number five, Community Compact. Reading this, I think it solidifies my knee-jerk reaction to no.
No, I read it too.
And it just reiterates, no. I don't know.
So what is the...
To me, it's more red tape.
Yeah.
It's more controlled by the government.
That's what I get out of it, too.
To me, it's mandates.
Yeah.
And you being on the school committee, we shared that. And the biggest unfunded mandate is in education.
And when they go
right to their website, their first thing is education best practices.
Yeah.
And for them to tell us, and part of the team is...
Oh, no, so maybe I want to be... doubly clear as to what...
Yeah, so floor is yours, sir.
So Community Compact, there are a number of initiatives. Education was not one of the ones that we were suggesting. Energy was our suggestion that, in fact, that this building is going to cost a lot of money to fix or repair. Part of the repairs to the building will be windows, and one of the things that would or could be served and saved would be, in fact, something to do with energy. If we need to replace our boilers, that would be money. And again, it comes with strings. I would never deny that. But at the same time, I would want to explore this thing or take at least enough due diligence going forward with this thing to determine what the pain might be of getting money to replace furnaces. And that's where I'm headed.
So the grants aren't there unless we're involved in this?
There are several, again, back to energy, several approaches to energy. One of the ways, and we brought the contractor in that Tantasqua uses, and he looked at the highway. The payback for the project that he would pick for the highway barn was like 6-point-something years or 7 years. Makes totally no sense to go to the highway barn for a 7-year. There's no return. Now looking at this building with the work that we've had with respect to the building and what needs to be done is to have resources, and when I say resources, grant monies, to actually bring somebody in to look at the building from an energy perspective. And where I'm kind of focused almost immediately is the repair or replacement of the furnaces that we just put gas in. And would that be something that could be paid back in a couple of years? And if we were to take the $140,000 that comes with the Mass Compact, would we, or is it prudent that we take advantage of that money, understanding the strings that are related to that energy project? So again, I'm not asking you to go sign up for education. I'm asking you to sign up to work on energy projects.
Unless someone presents exactly what's mandated, and you can invite somebody.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
To me, I won't close the door, but right now, I'm not.
And again, I wanted to be clear that we brought this forward for three things: regionalization of water, the interconnections between the different towns with respect to water, the senior center, senior activity, which could mean a van or buying a van, and the third, the most important one. Or what was consensus was energy being the most important, where we're overspending what we thought we were spending, 30% over what we expected to spend for energy, to look into what that's coming from.
But I'd almost make the argument that those grants are available.
Well, sure.
You know, I remember when you had that guy, you said he came down from Tantasqua.
Yeah, he's their energy consultant.
Yeah. Now, wasn't he talking, if I remember right, he was talking about there was different grants out there for this.
Oh, there are. And where I was headed with it is that the way that they operate is like the Mass Save kind of thing, where they come in and you pay the bill and you get a return from a payback year over year, and that's how it pays back. And what I was thinking about looking for the compact dollars is that you'd actually start off by hiring a contractor that's not experienced in energy and experienced in an old building like this to say what could you do rather than
I think we had that done a couple years ago as well. And the return on investment wasn't there.
And again, there may not be a return, and if there's not a return, you just don't
there's always going to be a return. But
now, wasn't that too, this program, I mean, we put out so much and then they give us so much back, right?
No, Cindy, help me with that one. The program that
What was the program that we put out? And
you
then
put
they,
up, and then they paid
and
back.
And they paid back.
There's another program.
Is that another program?
You're correct. There's another program.
There's another program.
Yeah.
I remember
I just thought
like that.
Not to say that it's easy working with the government, since I'm working with them on the Mass Historical stuff.
Anything that you work with them, just I'm not comfortable.
No, that's fine. What I will do, though, is I will explore this further, but what I would look to is energy, and I'm really looking at this building.
I'm not opposed to anything. My heart's in this building as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's where I was coming for.
Okay.
All right, so we'll work on it.
All right. Item number 6, vacation carryovers. With a few new developments in Dunbrook, Herb and Donald are asking permission to extend their vacation carryover. I would entertain a motion to allow that to occur.
I will make that motion.
I'll second it.
And with a huge thank you. Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Under other, please advise the board that the 30-year-old Forest truck needs a new transmission and brake work. The estimate from Woodard's is $28,2290. Could be more due to the age of the truck. Plans to have work done and cover the cost from the current fire asset repair budget and to have the account replenished at a fall special town meeting. Were you made aware of that, Dave?
Yes, sir.
We all got this email, so you can have this copy. The fire truck, forest truck. Make your board aware of that. Thank you. Correspondence, charter. This letter is to inform you a new channel addition to our lineup taking effect on or after August 2nd. Following new channels will be added temporarily to the charter extended tier of programming during the upcoming Summer Olympic Games to carry the overflow programming of these popular events.
Channel 394, it's an HD channel. It's going to cover the NBC Olympic basketball. And channel 395 will cover the NBC Olympic soccer. We have a letter of appreciation. I saw this in an email.
I did too.
I couldn't read it at all. Oh, I did read. I was able to read. It was about the ability of Donald and his mowing.
Yeah. Yes,
he's yes, that was nice.
Quite talented.
Is it Miss Sylvia Jane?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
That's what I couldn't read. Was the signature. Yeah. So she's commending Mr. Hebert for his
Herbert.
Skill. Mr. Herbert. I will say
there
Hebert.
Hebert.
Come
that's
claw,
the candy
come toys. I'm not offended by it, so hopefully he's not as well. So that's that. Any other business before the board?
Can you please repeat channel 395 will cover Olympic soccer.
395 will cover NBC Olympic soccer.
Thank you.
Yeah. Or football, they say. Yes, sir.
Just another opportunity for these grants. And so there's a meeting up in Leominster, and I think I'll shoot up.
10?
Yeah, I'll shoot up. Because this is USDA stuff, and we have, again, because of the recognition of the town and its agricultural history, we could qualify.
Well, that's how USDA, that's where Wagon Wheel got their grant.
Exactly.
Exactly. Served.
And it's about buildings. Catch my theme.
I got your theme. Any other business before the board?
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
What's going on with selling of the dam or lake, whatever that is, if it's located in North Brookfield,
up behind? Oh, we was actually supposed to have, we do have a deposit. The gentleman was actually supposed to come tonight, believe it or not, coincidentally, to give more of a deposit, and he was looking to close in a month's time. He's having an inspection, I think. Oh, you didn't talk to him, did you? He's having an inspection done in a week or two. He has the finances lined up and looking to close, like I said, in about a month.
Inspection on what?
The bank wants an inspection.
Oh.
On his end.
What was the price the town's giving? 20?
I think it was 20,000.
It's been
quite a long time.
That check, I'll believe it.
Well, I came here one night. He gave me $2,000 in cash for a deposit. I went to the bank and got a cashier's check the next day, brought it to town, and so we do have money in hand as a deposit.
Good.
Any other business?
Oh, yeah.
You're going to ride down the road and say, I should have said that too, aren't you?
Accountant.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
We had an individual come in giving us a price, approximately $25,000 for a size town like this, training with clerks and whatnot. Going to work it up a little bit more, come back. We do have potentially two candidates from that packet. Linda's been charged with looking.
I'm going to look into them and if we can set up something next week.
I would ask maybe even next Tuesday if we wanted to start early, if they could come in early.
Yeah, I'm going to get in touch with them in the next few days.
We could interview them before our 6 o'clock meeting. Mm-hmm. We could post it. Maybe one at 5, one at 5.
And then 15. This girl that came in, because she came in yesterday and she talked with the financial team. We had her in. And she said even, if we hire somebody, and they can train them from the municipal government.
Excellent.
And
I think we really need to pull the trigger by September 1st.
Yeah, we have to do something.
Or we're really taking advantage of Joan.
Yeah, we have. Joan wants, and so she said that they can train them, and they'll give us all their proposals, and then she said when a 3-month period is up, they're the ones that would do the review, because they said they really know what they're looking for.
So given that, pardon me, Steve.
I was going to say, as far as I'm concerned, training-wise, I'd want Joan to train if we hire.
No, I don't know if Joan wants to stay and do the
but
training.
But if we pull, we'd ask her, but I don't trust anybody over Joan.
Some of the time, yeah.
Well, these people are, this girl was the Hubbard, before she got involved with her firm, she was the town accountant up in Hubbardston.
So a close second, but I'm extremely impressed with Joan.
Oh, I'm very impressed with Joan, too.
And appreciative of what she's done.
Mm.
So we would time the audit to do before September 1 kind of thing? Or
the audit would be at their discretion.
They're coming in the end of August, they say.
The end of August, okay. Good. Well, timed about right.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
We have to pull the trigger. We have to do something.
Yeah, okay, exactly.
So I'll see. It's two different ones have come in. So
if you can send, I'm glad you reminded me. Thank you. If you can schedule that for Tuesday night's meeting, and when we post it, what do we want, 20 minutes? It usually
Tuesday
only lasts about 15 minutes for an interview.
We start at 5:30.
One at 5:30 and one at 5:45.
You were going to put a matrix together of questions?
With three of us, yeah.
We can email a couple questions to Karen and
put a matrix together.
Root out. I don't think it's a violation of open meeting law.
No. Just have the matrix.
Root out a few questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we can always meet before to see where we are with questions.
So we want to do that for August 2nd.
Our next meeting, yeah.
August 2nd at 6 p.m.
A 5:30 interview. If there's only two individuals, a 5:30.
That's next week already.
Yeah.
That's okay. August is next week.
Oh,
the summer is gone.
Yes. Okay. So we want to do one appointment.
5:30 is good.
5:30.
Worst cases, we can open in the selectman's office.
Grab a copy of that.
Okay.
We good?
Yep, we're good.
Entertain a motion to adjourn?
I'll make
7:30.
Motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. So, Tony, you have an idea.